Well, we're here at the Rivoli Ballroom somewhere in South London with Noel Gallagher, the man at large at the moment. You're everywhere. Can't get away from you. Every time you switch the telly on, you probably see yourself, don't you?
I did see myself on telly yesterday in an ad break, yeah.
Did you like looking at yourself?
Not really, no. No. No, because it's usually stills or bits of videos. I don't do good videos, so...
Do you ever peek at the photographs that when you haven't taken? Do you have to approve all that sort of stuff?
I got to approve.
That's weird. You can't. It's never a good enough shot.
I have to approve all the photographs, yes, for various magazines. But yeah, no, I don't mind. It's better than leaving it to the editor, who's usually an idiot.
It's turned into a fashion show. This already
has it.
Talking like Marie Claire or something.
Well, you know, it's nice to get to the level of approving your own pictures. It's a status symbol.
It's the place that you occupy.
Absolutely.
Now. We're in the Rivoli Ballroom in South London, and you pick this venue. And it is amazing. There's a touch of the wheel tapestry about it, but that's the colour. Yeah. That's that deep red colour. But
I'm amazed they've allowed me and my fans to be in here, because it could get quite...
How did you find it? Was it one of your
friends? We did a photo shoot for Oasis here years ago, maybe in this very spot, and we often said, oh, it'd be great to do a gig there, and when this thing came up, it was like, oh, let's try that. So, like I say, I'm amazed they allowed let us do it, but I'm looking forward to it.
Right, have you got any instructions for the audience? Like, behave yourselves. Do not rip the velvet off the walls.
No, I always find if you tell somebody not to do something, there's always one idiot who's all willing to do it. You know what I mean? So I'm not going to say a great deal.
It's amazing looking at a project like this, because you don't see them coming along that often. I'm being slightly serious just for a moment. You recorded Abbey Road, and you started this project months and months ago, didn't you? It's like a build-up to it. I mean, it was a long... I mean, even before... Once the record is complete,
I finished it last June, yeah.
Yeah, and you were talking about the gigs and the tour and the album before Christmas. It's extraordinary, the projects... I don't see many projects like this anymore. Basically.
Well, because I'm an independent artist, when I finish a record, it then takes at least 6 months to license it around the rest of the world. So it literally means you've got to send somebody off with the CD in a briefcase, because I don't have record deals anywhere in the world, because if I signed to a major, I'd be tied in all the world.
So America, you need to do deals for America.
I'm on an indie label in America as well. It's a more noble thing to try and do and pull off, but it means it takes months to set it all up, do you know what I mean?
But it means you're in control then, more or less, isn't it?
Well, totally, yeah. And, you know, you don't have the Arnie Fufkins of this world.
Did you learn that through your Sony days?
Having been on a major record label, they're great and all that when you're at the level that Oasis was at. Mm. But for somebody like me, I'm not sure whether it works. And what I really didn't, or what I really don't want now is, I don't want people down at the studio when I'm recording telling me that, you know, what I should be doing at my age. Do you know what I mean?
You gave up on that a long time.
We never had that in Oasis. But what I'm saying is, if I was to go to a major record label now, you know what I mean? I don't know. They're just the people that run those labels, although there are great people in them, the majority of the people are just, they're not for me. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. They're not for me. I meet them out and about, and I think...
You ever listened to the A&R department anyway?
Well, I never had an A&R department, is what I'm saying, and I don't want one now. You know, when you're on Creation, you're not A&R'd, you know, and then from then, when we split from Creation or Creation collapsed, we went on our own, and we didn't have an A&R department. And sometimes, to be honest, in Oasis, that we would have benefited from having an A&R department, because we could barely agree on anything. It would have been nice for somebody from a record label to say, this is what we're doing. But... for now, no, I don't want an A&R.
It's interesting, because when you talk about the band and Oasis getting to this point, you learn all that with the band, and now you can use that knowledge to progress, can't you, and be in control and know what and what not to do and who to deal with.
Well, the key is what you've just said there, is the latter thing. It's not knowing what to do, it's knowing what not to do, do you know what I mean? So all the things that we should have avoided doing in Oasis, I can avoid those now. Mm. And keep all the good bits and try and somehow bring that into what you do. But it's not vastly different, I've got to say.
You're still a bit old school, aren't you?
Well, can't be anything but. I'm older. Yeah, yeah. It's on a much smaller scale. It's pretty much the same. Do you know what I mean? I mean, obviously, that band was colossal, but the attitude is still the same.
Yeah.
My attitude towards everything is still the same. Anyway,
I'm looking at the schedule here. It's quite.
Yeah, I don't. I don't look at it.
I would be like, really?
Yeah.
Have I really got to that point when I'm touring most of the world for most of the year?
Yeah. Well, what they don't put in there is they're just the days off. I've got to do stuff as well. So, but I mean, I'm kind of sat around the house for two years leading up to this point.
But that makes it totally schizophrenic, going from quiet to doing the record. And
It does. My doctor's not best pleased. But there you go. Such is the life we choose for ourselves.
I remember seeing Richard Hawley years ago. I think he'd played a gig at the Royal Albert Hall, which you play for Teenage Cancer Trust. And he came in the morning after. He said, "You don't know what it's like finishing the show. I go back to a lonely hotel bedroom with a packet of fags and a bottle of wine. It's absolutely does my head in." You know, that kind of... It's the adulation and the coming down, which
that's never.
And you used to party on though, didn't you?
Oh yeah, of course.
You partied right through.
Yeah, but you can't do that when you get to our age. You know, you can do it once a month maybe. Do you know what I mean? Like for instance, tomorrow night I'm playing the TCT. Is it tomorrow?
Yeah,
it's tomorrow night. And I got 4 days off now, and it's a Saturday night. Now clearly there's going to be a bit of damage done tomorrow night, but that will be my party wings clipped then until the summer, I would have thought.
Or is it a nice bottle of red wine these days? What?
It'll be more than that.
I don't really want to explore
it. They'll have to pour us out of the Albert Hall at 5 a.m, I would have thought. Yeah. But
you still like to party, but you pick your
times.
But you know what? If you have a really great show and you hire a kite, you'd want to have a party, I think.
Yeah, but I don't. I've you know, with experience. There's just like you can't do it when you're a singer. You cannot do it. Mm. That's what I've learned. It's one of the things where Oasis maybe suffered was, you know, it's like you cannot. You've got to be on it from 9 o'clock every night, and that means you can't be still up shouting, singing Beatles songs off a balcony at 5 o'clock in the morning.
It was great, wasn't it?
And that was great. Yeah, but when you're 25, that's great and it's brilliant. Mm. When you're like 47, that's insanity. You know, so. When I do great shows, I just, you know, I keep a lid on it and then see.
That's a secret though, isn't it?
Well, it is, because Saturday night will be the first time I've played in London on a Saturday night for a while, and all my friends are going to be there. And for all the great shows that I've done so far, tomorrow night is the night that we...
Roll out the hole though, man.
Yeah, well, tomorrow night is the night we party for all those great shows, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
There'll be some crisps eaten tomorrow.
it's quite a weird situation because you do that, you're in that cycle where you're writing, I don't know, it took you maybe 18 months to write, you record the album, then it's done. And then I remember talking to the Doves about it, Jimmy especially, that he got into that whole cycle thing that did his head in. It's like, you know, start, tour, back in the studio, write. And once you're aware that you're on a hamster on a wheel, that's when it gets strange, isn't it? Yeah. When you're aware of these little weird processes you're going through.
Well, again, with me not being on a record label, it's my record label that's funded by me, for me. I'm not affiliated to anybody. Nobody fronts any of the money for the things that I do.
Do you have to do all the meetings with that as well?
I try to do as little as possible. I've got people who I trust in the meetings, but all the collateral comes from me. So it means that if I want to get off the merry-go-round at any point, I can just, that's it. Nobody's pushing me to
make
records.
It's like a punk ethic, isn't it?
It is, and not a lot of people realise that.
It's almost DIY, isn't it?
Because they think, you know, the word punk, people think green hair and leather jackets and Sid Vicious, but
a bit more to them
the punk ethic, you're absolutely right. I think what I do in its spirit, I think what Oasis always did, and we were a punk band, you know what I mean? We got off our, I mean, you know, because you're from where we come from, we got off our asses, and we had very little talent to speak of, but when the five of us came together, you know what I mean, and whatever the chemistry
sparks
was, it worked,
flew,
you know, and we seen an opportunity and we took it, and there you go, you know.
Well, that's kicking the door down, isn't it? Like the Clash did that.
Yeah, well, it is. It's like you say, it's punk rock, you know.
You know, somebody has to kick these doors down for others to follow through.
Well, of course.
I wonder if you look around and you see, I know you used to go out to a lot of gigs, didn't you? You used to see a lot of gigs.
Yeah.
And I wonder if you look around and you see anything in any band Do you see you in anything out there? Do you hear anything of you?
There was that explosion 10 years ago of Kasabian and the Libertines and Arctic Monkeys and Razorlight and all that. And not only did I see it, they were very upfront about saying definitely maybe and all that. Since then, not really. This thing with Jake Bugg was kind of a bit heartbreaking, because I thought, oh, he's a lad, you know what I mean? He's a bit like me, you know, he's 16, he's writing tunes in his bedroom, and you get his album and you find out he didn't write half of them anyway. Right. You know, and it was a kind
disappointing.
Of... Disappointing. I mean, he's a great lad, I've toured with him, he's brilliant, I'm a fan of his. But as for... I was talking to this about someone the other day, you know, about the 90s and all that, and the main difference between then and now is, then it was all bands. There was no solo artists. Mm. It was all groups. And now it's all solo artists. And the band is kind of...
The economics of that are cheaper, though, aren't they? You've got a guitar and a light and a spot.
It's a terrible state of affairs. But I'm sure it'll come back. But I don't hear anybody say anymore that I'm a vast influence on people. And that doesn't bother me at all.
And you are a solo artist as well. People forget that.
Yeah, yeah. But I'm
stating the obvious there, but like Weller, you associate Weller with a band, don't you? So you're associated with the band, with a group around you.
Yeah. I mean, I'll forever be associated with it. Because like Weller and The Jam and The Star Council, only because those bands were so huge and meant so much to people. It's like, you know, McCartney will always be Paul from the Beatles, you know, no matter, that's just the way it is.
I was talking to a couple of journalists, slightly younger than us, Noel, you'd be pleased to know. As 10-year-old kids, they were buying Oasis record and it moved them. One was from Essex, he got into Blur, then he, Oasis came along and it was kind of represents me as a kid, a scruffy ass kid. And the other was like, yes, I was 10 years old. And so when you talk about influence, you're influencing people who write, who in fashion and film, it goes a bit more beyond music,
yeah, I guess,
in a way.
I
and
guess.
The attitude that you created and still do is...
Well,
it's kind of a British thing, isn't it?
There's a comedian from Glasgow called Kevin Bridges.
Yeah, I know,
aware of him. So I'm kind of minding my own business one afternoon and I get something sent to the office from this lad called Kevin Bridges, who I'd never heard of. And he sent me his DVD and it was like a proper DVD. And with this letter from him saying pretty much that it's not your influence is not music, because he's saying he was sat at home watching an interview with some of us from Oasis saying whatever you're going to be and pointing directly into the screen, and he thought, well, that's me, I'm you know, I better start being a comedian, you know what I mean. And he sent me this lovely letter and thanked me in the credits on his DVD, and we've since become pals, and he's a brilliant comedian. So you're right, he was influenced by the spirit of, you know, just get off your ass and do something. You know,
it's interesting the way you've worked through it all, because when I look at the industry now, without sounding like Stadler and Waldorf, and I really don't want to, because I've got both boys in bands, you know, and I see the money they make is just, it's an outrage. It's really, 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 really tough, and I don't really understand the industry, but you've managed to continue trying to understand it and evolve. That's a trick in itself, I think, to understand
it
now.
I'm really fortunate to have come along when we did. Mm. To start off now, if I had the same attitude I had when I was 25, but I'd be sat here today, I'm not sure whether I'd end up in this position, because the musical climate that we're in, although we can sit and say, wow, it's crying out for another rock and roll star, just the song itself, another one of those songs, you know, the first thing they do is say, that's great, but we've got this co-writer who works for us as well, you want to get in with him, you know, he's really into the Beatles, do you know what I mean? And maybe it would be a lot different. But because I guess I've got so much past and history behind me, I carry a certain bit of weight, I guess.
Do you realise now the importance of Oasis and what you did there?
It's only... I got to say, I'm... When I do five Oasis songs in my set, and I was on stage at Glasgow at the Hydro a couple of weeks ago, and the entire front bit that you can see is all under 20 years of age, all of them, boys and girls. mostly girls, I have to say, which is another marvellous trick I've managed to pull off. I don't know how that's managed to come about. But, and I do Champagne Supernova with the choir, and it's like a hymn. And all of a sudden, everyone's on everybody's shoulders. Not one of these people, lads with their tops off, singing it like it's the greatest thing, were even born when it was written. And somehow they've taken it and they're singing it like crying, do you know what I mean? Like it's a football anthem. And that's an amazing thing. And I'm kind of stood on there playing it. Part of me's thinking, I initially start thinking, when I do songs, I'm kind of halfway through them and I turn it on stage and I think, what is this song about? What is it about? I have no idea what this song is. And, you know, because you're on autopilot sometimes. And I'm sat playing Champagne Supernova thinking, what is this song about? And then you kind of glance up and you see this and you think, well, that's what it's about.
It's the music of the terraces.
Yeah, that's what it's about. It's not about the words or the melody. So I'd like to have stopped the gig there and took a consensus.
It's interesting about that record. You can never really nail that as a band, that live. And now you've probably learned through, because it never reached those heights, that song with the band, did it?
No, they were the demos. You know, it's like, oh, it definitely maybe took 5 years to make because we were doing that set for 3 years in Manchester. Morning Glory, no one had heard the song still the night before, so they were effectively the demos. So, because we never had a chance to develop those songs, it's only, I mean, I'm not, what I do with it now is vastly different, and those songs are sacrilege to Oasis fans. But it is like a hymn, you know what I mean? And maybe given the time, it might have been different. But the great thing about it, you're right with that record, you can't really pin that album down. There's so many. I mean, people love that record, and I'm kind of a bit indifferent to it. Do you know what I mean? I'm like, it's all right.
It's because it's your own. Well, it's like seeing the kids growing up and run off and having a life of their own, isn't it?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
They'll never have a life.
But I mean, I remember talking on the last record you did, and we were just talking about, without sounding old and grey, that you didn't really know what you were doing with Definitely Maybe. And we need to put some context in that, because you had no idea.
No.
You scrapped it and started again, but still probably when you finished it, you probably didn't know what you've just achieved or recorded. No idea.
Yeah. It was, honestly, it was only in, we went on tour in 2005, this is Oasis now, on the Don't Believe the Truth tour. And the first night we did it was the first night I'd ever noticed that the audience had got younger. We'd seem to have been playing to the same audience from 1994 right the way to the previous tour, which would have been 2003 or two. And then we walk out on stage on the first night, wherever it is, and there's kids there. And I'm like, wow, that's really interesting. And then I hadn't noticed it again until this tour. So it seems to be in 10-year cycles that band and those songs, whatever it is we did, keeps regenerating.
God, I bet Liam misses all that, doesn't he? Seriously,
I would hope so. I'd hope that he does.
How could you not?
Well, exactly. How could you not?
The heady heights.
Yeah, I wouldn't say. I would say to that, while he was doing it, he didn't seem to enjoy it very much. So you know, there's an irony there for us all.
Well, sorry, with the little pass, did he come and watch one of the shows?
No, he didn't. That wasn't either. He was not. That's not. That was my other brother's pass. So
because I was saying to a couple of journalists the other day, talking about the. I'm not going to ask you about the reformation of Oasis because it's not the point. I said, by the end of the year, I reckon Liam might come and sing a song with Noel somewhere. And I'm asking you to answer that. It would make perfect sense.
I can answer it for you if you want. It won't be happening.
Well, there's a million kids hoping that happens, really.
Well, good for them. They've got the... You know, I get it everywhere I go, all over the world, you know, about...
Do you get sick of the whole thing? But I suppose you talked about it with a lot of fondness, the whole group now.
It was an amazing experience. It was an amazing experience in my life, and something that I would never just, you know, like, you know, some Stalinist just go, it didn't exist. I still do the songs, you know. I'm really proud of what that band achieved. I'm also really... I'm really grateful that I actually wrote those songs and I legitimately can get to do them. Do you know what I mean? And people say to me all the time, oh, you know, this, that, and they say, yeah, but you've got the records. And to you, those records mean more than they do to me. To me, it's work, you know what I mean? So when you listen to the records, it's bringing back your memories of your life. Why would you want to relive it? And of course, if you sit down and tell the people, they don't really want to relive it.
No.
They don't really
like to be reminded of the happier times.
I mean, you know, we do, what people don't understand is that for them it would be one night, and it would be clearly it would be amazing for them. But for the people in the band, it would be like a full year of. And the last time we toured, ask anybody who was on that tour, it wasn't great. The gigs were all right and all that, but
have you blocked it out of your memory?
No, I know, no, I don't block anything. I know, I remember it, which is why I don't want to. That's why I don't want to do it again.
Yeah. You know, I wonder how you'll view your solo career then, say in 20 years' time. Have you thought about that one?
Where it's up to now, it's all about the records for me. The two records that I've made are great. They stand up with anything that I've done previously, singles wise, and more importantly, the videos have kept a consistent level of shitness. So I think that in that respect, you know, I'm kind of doing all right. I've got down there with videos and it's staying down there, so I'm pleased with that. And the records are great, and I'm even I'm interested in what I might come up with next. Do you know what
I mean? Well, you'll have phases like Paul Weller, won't you? You'll probably work that way out. You get into that. You're getting into that.
I do hope not.
Well, you know what I mean? The jam.
Yeah. Of course.
Style Council were great. You know.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, after the gigs in Glasgow and Manchester, I was, my missus come to the gigs and she was saying, she said, you know, when you started this, you told me it wasn't going to be like a football match. I thought it was going to be a bit more considered and, you know, saxophones and this and that. And I said, yeah, but so did I. And she said, well, how's it got to back to the football match thing so quickly? And I was like, I have no idea, but I'm glad it has.
But that is your crowd.
I know.
They've grown up with you.
I know, bless them.
With your football and your terrace rock and all that. A couple of questions before we finish. Been a terrible week for entertainment, Noel. Zane's left One Direction. Jeremy Clarkson is not doing Top Gear.
I know.
They letting the whole entertainment side down?
I don't know about the guy from One Direction. I don't know. Jeremy Clarkson, I mean, poor. It was like a slow news week, you know what I mean? The amount of times I've wanted to leather someone when I haven't had a start. And trust me, when you get to our age, when you get hungry, you don't get hungry, you get fucking furious. And the amount of times I've wanted to slap people in catering when it ain't ready, they're numerous. And I'm only glad I don't work for the BBC, or I too would have been fired.
Are you stroppy? Are you kind of? Do you get more stroppy or more considered these days?
I don't. I think I'm all right to work with. What I, much to my tour manager's amusement, is I cannot stand the details. He'll come up to me and he'll say, when he walks, he has a look on his face, and I'll just go, "What is it now?" And he'll say, "You know, when we're in Hong Kong in 2017, I'm just booking taxis now. So, what time do you think you'd like to leave the hotel for the sound check?" And I'm like, "What the fuck? What the fucking hell? What? When?" It's like, you know, next June. Like, Neil, really, please.
Do you complain about the champagne being tepid at all? Have you ever found yourself doing that? The champagne, darling, is too warm.
No. I do notice that there's a magnificent spread in the dressing room today, so it must mean I'm shifting no records this week, because I think there's a plastic bowl of nuts and an orange and maybe some goat milk. But I'm not one for checking the riders and all that. I don't care about things like that.
What really matters is it getting on the stage and just doing it right?
What really matters is that the monitor engineer has got his shit together, and the rest of the band have got their shit together, and the front of house fella, he's got his shit together. The rest of it looks after itself.
How do you cope with, one last question, because we could go on and ever, and you've got a nice stage to go on to. How do you cope with when the audience say that was the best thing I've ever seen, and for you it really wasn't? Do you let the cat out of the bag, or you just let it sit with you? A comedian gets laughs in the different places in different cities, you know that.
Yeah, I know. I do, when I'm on tour, I do a blog thing. Yeah, I do kind of let it out, I'm afraid. But that's, you know, this is what I've learned about being on tour. There's maybe been 6 times in my career so far where some nights you come off stage and you'll go, "That was the greatest thing we ever did," and somebody will come in like the sound man and say, "Oh no, half the PA went down for the first half of the set," and you'll go, "Oh no." So then, or you know, the bass player will say, "Oh god, I've had a nightmare, amp blew up for 4 songs, didn't you hear it?" So I think I've only had 6 gigs where everybody, the sound man's come in and gone, that was amazing, and we've gone, won it. And then the lighting guy's come in and gone, that was unbelievable, and you go, won it. And then you see, so I've only ever had that about six times. I can remember one was in Belfast, Main Road. It was a night in Hong Kong, which is like odd places. So usually when you do a gig, and I come off and I think, well, I've had one shit gig on this tour, which is in Dusseldorf. And when we come off between the encore and the end of the gig, walking out, I'm like thinking, well, that was a struggle. The rest of the band all come in high five and each other going, that's the best thing we've ever
done. Yeah, but you don't let the cat out of the bag. Oh, yeah, I've been like that. Yeah, it was brilliant.
Listen, I revel in letting the cat out of its bag. I'm like, really, you think that was good? Have a look in this bag. There's a big angry cat in here. He's dying for a steak.
I was recently talking to Noddy Holder. I said, give us 3 points to be successful. What are your 3 main points to be successful in the music business? He said, accountancy and management. 2 was friendship within the band, and number 1 was the song. Has he got them in the right order?
For me, it's the songs first and foremost, because they're what lasts forever. In my own experience, band members come and go. Mm. The songs are there forever and ever. My thing now is a testament to that, you know. And for me, there really is only one thing. I can stand not being friends with anybody. I don't give a fuck about that. I didn't join a band to make friends. The money thing, that looks after itself, because that's all wrapped up in lawyers and all that. Now, I can understand Noddy saying that, because in the 70s it was a bit more...
90% tax.
It was a bit more... Oh, good God. Oh, hang on a minute. You're giving me...
You're getting 10p out of every pound you...
What, now? No.
This is going back to the 70s. Like being back at the gas board.
For me, it's the songs. Right. For me, it's the songs and a good PA. Having a good PA is priceless. Does anybody know any? I'm joking, Kat, obviously.
You're making the crew here slightly more nervous as you go along. Is this reverse psychology?
No, they're not. I've just got to have a chat with my mate, the lighting guy, over the smoke machine fucking debacle the other night.
What happened with it? What happened? It didn't work.
I'm on stage in Utrecht, wherever that is, and I'm kind of singing and thinking, where are the crowd gone? And I look and there's just a smoke machine bellowing smoke out. And honestly, when I was breathing in to sing, I was breathing in oil, so much so that my voice started to go. And then, it wasn't just seeping out, it was blowing out like the fucking Titanic
like
going down.
It was unbelievable. Or something.
And I was like, Fuji man, what are you doing? And so since then, there's been no smoke.
Right.
So we have to find a common ground, Fuji, where there's
no
just
smoke without fire.
There's just the right amount of smoke to make it look cool and not like a Bauhaus gig.
Noel Gallagher, it's always good to sit down.
Thank you very much, Pete.
Don't go changing.
I'll try not to.